Sunday nights, we are in a study of the number 7. And this is the most interesting study I've ever done on Revelation because I'm using the springboard, the number 7, for this study. In fact, what brought me into that, we have been studying the history of Israel and all of these kings of Israel. And of course, you start in the book of 1 Samuel when Saul becomes king. In fact, the people cry against God in the 8th chapter of 1 Samuel and say, give us a man to be king over us. And of course, God was king. And that starts in 1 Samuel, the 8th chapter. Of course, Samuel was the mouth of God up to that point. And then we've been going down through these kings, and you end down here with the last king of Israel and Judah. Judah is southern Israel. Northern Israel was the 10 tribes. Southern Judah was the 2 tribes of Judah and Benjamin. And you end Israel down here in 586 B.C. when southern Judah is carried into captivity by the Babylonians, and northern Israel is carried into captivity when Hoshea is the king in 722 B.C. And then, of course, what we came down to was Jehoram, the son of Ahab. And Jehoram was king of northern Israel there in the 5th chapter of 2 Kings when a man named Naaman, he was the commanding general of Syria. And Syria is just north of Israel. Syria was the old ancient enemies of Israel along with one other. There's probably 2 real serious enemies of Israel. One was the Philistines, which is the word Palestinian comes from that. That's the Gaza Strip. That's the old ancient land of the Philistines. Gaza was one of the main cities of the old Philistine Empire. And then Syria. Syria and the Philistines were brothers. One of the writers tells us that there was a highway built from Syria and down here on the coast of Israel down to the land of the Philistines. And the men that came down and immigrated down here to the land of the Philistines were actually Syrians. So these are actually cousins or brothers. And then you've got one other system that was a great enemy of Israel, and that was the land of Ammon, the Ammonites. That's northern Jordan. So these people were, Israel was sandwiched between the Philistines and the Ammonites, and of course, the Syrians would come down and make raids on them and declare war against them, and they were always doing that. Well, of course, Naaman was the general of Syria, and he had leprosy, and he came down to northern Israel to the prophet Elisha, and Elisha tells him to dip 7 times in the Jordan to cleanse his leprosy. Well, all through the Scripture, leprosy is one of the pictures and types of sin. We know that leaven was a type of sin also. But leprosy is a type of sin. And 7 had to do with getting rid of leprosy. And a baptism is a blood baptism. And we talked about 7 being a word that actually meant, it doesn't merely mean the number 7 numerically, as we would say. I was reading in my McClintock and Strong, and they tell you that this was a cultural thing, particularly 7 above all the numbers of the Bible, has more allegorical meaning than any other number. And we're talking about the word 7. And to kind of complete this, let me go back to the words I've been putting up every week, the word S-H-A-B-U-W-A-H, Shabuah, and the word S-H-A-B-U-A, Shabuah. These words come from one another. And the word Shabuah, that word is the word sevens in the 70 weeks of Daniel when the Scripture says that 70 weeks are determined upon thy people. Well, this word Shabuah, S-H-A-B-U-A, that word also is related to the word Shabuah. It comes from it, from the base word, and that word is the word oath. And whenever we take an oath to God, we don't just take an oath all of a sudden. An oath is what we take. An oath is our part of a contract or our part of a covenant. And when we take our part of the covenant, we sign the covenant. And how do we sign on the line? We sign on the dotted line with circumcision. And we can't do that to ourselves. God has to circumcise our hearts. That's the dotted line of the covenant of God. He said, you'll circumcise the foreskin to keep my covenant. But the real key to all of this is one of the words for seven. And there's a word, Shabbat, which comes from these two words, Shabbat. Shabbat comes from the word Shabuah, and the word that sounds much the same, that's spelled with an H, a W-A-H instead of U-A. And this word Shabbat means to seven oneself, to seven oneself. And seven would be like an adjective describing a believer. You could say sevened Dan, or sevened Mary, or sevened Barbara. A sevened person would be a person that had gone through so many things, that had gone through fire and trials and tribulation until they came to a point of bowing to the will of God, and that would be a cutting off of sin and taking an oath to God and being sevened. Well, when you go through the fiery trials and you become sevened, that's actually what they had in mind when they used the word seven, more than just the numerical value of seven. So this word to seven oneself means to be complete. To be complete. Well, when we think of that, when we think of seven, that's this word Shabbat. To be complete, I think of the New Testament word T-E-L-E-I-O-S, teleos. That word and the word derivative, T-E-L-E-I-O-T-E-S and T-E-L-I-O-S, all these are variables of the same word, and they mean to either to be completed or completion in itself. These are the words, all of them are related in the sense of when the Scripture says, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. Well, perfect, I believe, is the word teleos. And when he would say, leaving the principles of the doctrines of faith, let us go on unto perfection, there in the sixth chapter of Hebrews. And when he would speak of those that are of full age, full age, full age, that's the word teleos. And full age means to be mature or to be grown. And of course, when we look at 2 Peter 1:5, when the Bible says, besides all this, give all diligence, add to your faith. And then he names 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 things that we're to add to our faith. And the first thing that he says is virtue. Well, that word virtue does not just mean to be nice and good. The word virtue is the word A-R-E-T-E, arete, and that means manliness. Act like a man and grow up and be complete and be mature by becoming sevened and adding these seven things to your life. Well, when you see that word seven and it has this idea, and you're not even going to get any disagreement on this from what you would call liberal scholars or conservative. They're all going to be pretty much in alignment that this word seven means to be completed and to grow up and to mature. So when we're talking about sevens in the book of Revelation, and that's where we've gone to, we talk about the 70 weeks of Daniel or 70 times seven, and we know why that happened in the Old Testament, because there was a 490-year period, and Israel had a sabbatical year every 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years. And every seventh year, they had to let the land lie fallow. They couldn't plant. They couldn't reap in that year. And going into that, that was so that the land could restore the nutrients. And going into that year, they would plant in the sixth year, in the winter, certain crops that would grow. Well, they couldn't harvest those, and they had to let those, they had to let the poor, they had to let the cattle come in, and all of this. And of course, then in that seventh year, They couldn't plant anything in the winter. They couldn't harvest in the spring. So therefore, in the eighth year, they didn't have any harvest in the spring. And they had to wait till the fall of the eighth year, things that they would plant in the spring to harvest in the fall. So they were going well beyond it, right at 2 years before they could actually harvest anything. Well, Israel went for 70 sets of those years. In 70 sets of those every 7 years is 7 times 70. That's 490 years. And that's why God said they never kept my Sabbaths. Well, 70 times 7, that's the number of divine repentance. And Peter said, how many times shall I forgive a man? 7 times? And then Jesus said, forgive a man 70 times 7 if he repent. Don't go around passing out forgiveness unless he's repenting. So when we see Jesus telling that to Peter, it's actually alluding to the 70 weeks of Daniel, which is the number of divine repentance. And whenever someone has offended 70 times, you multiply that times 7. And God says that to Israel over there in the 26th chapter of Leviticus. He said, I'll punish you 7 times for your sins. I will 7 you is what he's saying. So when we get back to the book of Revelation and we find these sevens, we're finding the very essence of the number 7. If the book of Revelation, which means apocalypse, the word is A-P-O-K-A-L-Y-P-S-E, apocalypse. It comes from apo and kalupto, K-A-L-U-P-T-O. Apo means off or removal of the kalupto, that is the word cover. And it means to remove the cover. Now, that's not merely talking about Jesus coming back at the end of time. That's talking about much more than that. I believe what it's talking about, I've never even heard a preacher say this, I believe it's a removal of the cover. Now, John wrote the book of Revelation in 96 A.D. That's what most of your authorities believe. He wrote it around 96. And that he says each one of these angels are going to come and say, come up hither and let me show you a vision, well, of the things that are to come. I believe that Revelation is a picture of the New Testament church from the time of John all the way to the end of time. And it's a picture about all the trials that they're going to go through. But let me show you something that when you're studying all these sevens in Revelation, something you need to understand. The book is divided into sections. The first chapter, chapter 1 is, I keep saying this, chapter 1 is a glossary. It's a glossary. This will tell you how to identify. A glossary is a section of a book with difficult words to understand for the average reader. And of course, the word glossa is the Greek word foreign language. Foreign language. And that's the same word when they said, when they all spoke with other glossa as the Spirit gave them utterance. It's the same word in 1 Corinthians 15:1. Though I speak with the tongues, the gloss of men and angels, the foreign languages of men and angels. And it's the same word there in the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. 14th chapter of 1 Corinthians. When the writer Paul says, tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, them that believe not. It's the word glossa. And I'm not going to preach on tongues tonight. But the first chapter of Revelation is a glossary. And then the second and third chapter, this is a description of the seven churches, or as I said before, as the refined church. There were more than seven churches in Asia. There are many more than seven churches, but particularly some that come to mind is Mileta. When Paul was coming back on his second missionary journey, and he comes back, and he, well, actually his third missionary journey, excuse me, And he comes back, and he comes through Miletus, and he calls the elders of Ephesus down to talk to him there in the 20th chapter of Acts. You had Miletus, you had the church at Troas, you had the church at Colossae, and some others. So there are more than seven. Seven is just merely a number to show the refined church. There's not but one church. Church is the word ecclesia, E-K-K-L-E-S-I-A. It comes from kaleo, K-A-L-E-O, and ek. This word means to call out. And I like what Bauer says. It means to call out by name. God's got his family named, and the church is one church. There's not seven churches. There's not 8 or 10 or 15. There's one church. The church is the body of Christ. So seven actually being for that purpose. Now, the fourth chapter, I believe, shows that this is the New Testament church as much as anything else. Just very quickly, go back to the fourth chapter. Go back to the fourth chapter. We see a throne there in the fourth chapter. And then we see around the throne, we see 24 seats and 24 elders. I've said this, but I'll review it quick. The throne of God was in the tabernacle or the temple. The throne of God was the Ark of the Covenant, and that's where God sat. He came down out of the Shekinah glory cloud, and he sat there, and before the throne of God was the candlesticks here on the south side of the holy place, and then the altar of incense, and then the table of showbread here north. And the brazen sea was out right out the east door. The tabernacle faced east, and then the brazen sea was here. And we've already said that the sea, that was called the glassy sea there in the fourth chapter. And everything in the Old Testament is a shadow of the very image in the New. And here's the sea. I'll show this to you once more. Here is a Reader's Digest book, and this is the best picture of the Brazen Sea. And that Brazen Sea was built by Solomon. It was a laver at first, but
here it is,
a
laver.
Yeah, it's a laver here on that. Give me that colored picture there. It's a laver on here. Mary, we got this picture, and she said, "That's a laver." That was before they grew large enough to have a sea. And I said, "Isn't that funny? You know more than all the Baptist preachers in Tennessee." It's just funny. It's funny. But here's when it became permanent with Solomon's temple. There's the sea right there. That's because it held 2,000 baths for the priests every morning. They call that the sea. And I believe this is what Jesus was talking about when he was saying, "Say to this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea." In fact, I believe that there's a relationship between this sea and between this sea. This is kind of abstract thinking, and maybe I can just kind of get you to get a hold of this. All of the empires were built on the sea. And you have to remember, this was the greatest sea in the world as far as these inhabitants of the world at this time knew, because they said the earth had four corners and that's all it had. They knew nothing about the Atlantic Ocean, where it went to. They didn't know there was a Pacific Ocean. They thought you went out there and you fell off somewhere. So when the Bible speaks of the four corners of the earth, I need a map that goes all the way over to Spain and North Africa and the Strait of Gibraltar. And they thought that's all there was to the world. And this was the great monstrous sea here. And they believed that Dagon lived in the sea. And that's what they thought the whales were. And Jesus, Job says in Job 9 that God treads the sea, and that's why Jesus walked upon the sea. Well, when Babylon falls, it has to be cast into the sea. It has to fall into the sea. Well, of course, it falls in the sense, and this sea here, when you get into Revelation, this is figurative language. When the scripture says that the woman sits on the harlot in the first verse of Revelation, the 17th chapter, and that she's coming up, rising up out of the sea. Let me see if I can say this to you and have you understand it. You have to quit thinking literal. You have to think figurative. When you see the beast rising up out of the sea, a lion, a bear, and a leopard, and that was Babylon, Persia, Greece, and then Rome was a composite of these three. The reason you see it rising up out of the sea is because the boundaries of the Mediterranean Sea was the boundaries of the greatest sea in the world to these people. And all the peoples on the Mediterranean, these beasts rose up out of the sea because the borders of these empire was upon this Mediterranean Sea. That's allegorical, figurative type thinking. You have to think that way. And of course, the Bible says that the sea where they rose up from, where the sea where they rose up from, the waters where the woman sits, are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. Well, that's what's set up on this sea, was peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. Can you understand that figurative type thought? That's what you've got to keep in mind when you start seeing this. Well, the literal Babylon had to fall, and in a sense was cast into this sea. Let me show you something before I go any further, as long as I'm talking about this. Got so many places to go, I'm sitting here going. When you get into Revelation, there's so much to go to. But let me show you this. You really, when you're thinking, all of this was idiomatic language. Something being cast into the sea was an idiom back in that day and time. When it's you and I are cast into the sea, we're baptized, and without having to get into the subject, y'all know what I mean. The people listening will have to write to ask. But when we're cast into the sea, demons are washed out of us, or self is washed out of us. When Babylon is cast into the sea and there's no redemption in her, there's nothing to save her when she's cast into the sea. And you've got the cast into the sea. It was a terminology that meant a washing. Well, the washing is done in Israel by the Brazen Sea. You can find that sea in the 7th chapter of 2 Kings. But when Babylon is cast into the sea, it's because she, in a sense, is being washed of her iniquity, but she's dying. She's actually being washed of all that's evil in her, and there's nothing left of her, so she is actually cast into the sea. Let me give you an illustration of what I'm talking about. Before I do, let me just cover one thing here in the first chapter, but I'm going to come right back to this sea. In the first chapter, we see seven churches. And may I remind you, when I say the word seven, I don't mean a numerical number here. That's not what this means. This is talking about a sevened church. Then you have the seven spirits in verse 4, seven churches, verse 4, seven churches, verse 11, seven candlesticks, verse 12, seven candlesticks, verse 13, the seven stars in the right hand of Christ in verse 16. And then this glossary is revealed to us for the rest of the book. The fact being that verse 1 says, he sent and signified all of this by his angel unto John. Now the key word is signify. Signify is the word semiao, S-E-M-E-I-O-O, semiao. And semiao comes from the word S-E-M-E-I-O-N. That word means a flag or a sign, a sign. What God's going to do, it's a beacon, it's a signal. And what he's going to do is signal things. He's going to give you signs all through this book, and they're going to be figurative signs. He's not talking about literal. He's not talking about literal beast. If you've got a literal beast, then you've got a literal beast with seven heads and ten horns. And it looks like a lion, a bear, and a leopard. That beast was here in Daniel 7. It was Babylon, Persia, and Greece. Babylonian lion, the Persian bear, the Grecian leopard. Then that was overthrown by a composite of these three, which was Rome. Now, he tells you how to identify anytime you find seven angels with seven trumpets all through this book signaling something. He tells you in verse 20 how to identify them. Because you're going to find these seven angels all through here. Then he says here in verse 20, the mystery of the seven stars in the right hand of Christ, You have to remember the right hand. Anytime you find something in the right hand, when you find the little book in the right hand of Christ, it's going to equate with the seven stars in some respect, because the right hand is the hand of authority. When Christ is supposed to be sitting at the right hand of the Father, but the Father is a spirit. Well, if the Father is a spirit, and he's certainly not a gray-headed old man with a gray beard. He's the living God, and he never does grow old. He never sleeps, and he never slumbers. So we have to understand this is figurative language. The right hand is the hand of authority. Then he says, and the mystery of the seven stars, which was in his right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks, the seven stars in the right hand of Christ are the angels of the seven churches. Anytime you see seven angels, what they are the seven stars. When you see stars of heaven falling to earth in Revelation 8, 9, and 10, when each one of these angels has a trumpet, and the trumpets, I've said before, those are the arms on the candlesticks. That's what they are. And of course, he goes on to say that the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. And of course, angel is A-G-G-E-L-O-S, and it means messenger. Well, the preachers were called messengers. So let me just put it this way. Seven being the number of divine refinement, that the seven stars are the mature stars, are the complete stars, the complete message of God. They are the messengers of the seventh church. They are the seven candlesticks. That's what he says. Seven, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. So the candlesticks are the seven churches. The Spirit is the Holy Spirit. That's the refined Spirit. And that's the oil that's inside these beaten gold candlesticks. You have to keep that in mind. Seven not being just merely a numerical value number, but seven being a description of completion and maturity. So all the way through here, seven stars are the angels, are the messengers, are the refined messengers of the refined church. That's what it is. It's the refined message. Well, back over here, I'm going to show you this so you can see. When you're reading something, there's something, if you go to most seminaries, they'll tell you that there is something called the law of first mention. The first time something is mentioned, it holds that meaning. And this is the sovereignty of God. This is election predestination, that God arranges everything exactly. That when you find something, not only is it the first time it's mentioned, is it meant to be that exact way all the way through the Scripture, but every time you find it, it has a relative meaning to every other time you find it. So let me just show you what I'm talking about here in the 8th chapter. And when he had opened the 7th seal, we'll get into the seals later, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. Now, I already said, let me show you one of the best Revelation books you can get. Here's one of the best Revelation books you can get. It's called The Temple. It's Ministry and Services by Alfred Edersheim. It's about the temple, because you're going to find all through here, you're going to find the throne of God. You're going to find the crystal sea or the brazen sea in front of the throne. You're going to find the lamps, the seven lamps in front of the throne. And you're going to find all of this in the book of Revelation. Well, don't you think you need a book on the temple? Because this is where you're going to find it. And of course, right here in the 8th chapter, in the first verse, there's a silence in heaven. Well, of course, Israel was called the heavens. That was the ruling class. And when God said he's going to have new heavens and new earth in the 65th chapter of Isaiah, he's talking about old Israel fading away, and he's saying, I'll call my people by another name, New Testament church or Gentile church, Gentile elect of God. Well, here in the 8th chapter, this is a description of what happens right before the priests take a golden censer and light the altar of incense, and the altar of incense is equated with the prayers of the saints. Prayers of the saints. Well, and of course, the prayers of the saints in the fifth chapter of Revelation is equated as our prayers. That's what it's equated as. And this went up as a sweet savor to God as he was dwelling either in the Shekinah glory cloud or here when he would come down and sit up on the Ark of the Covenant. Now, and right before when he says, and I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to these seven angels were given seven trumpets. What are the seven angels? The messengers of what? Of the refined church. That's what they are. Now, when people come up and say, the Lord is going to deliver us from the hour of temptation in the third chapter of Revelation, therefore the church is out of here. What's it doing right here in the eighth chapter? Huh? What's the refined church doing right here? The seven angels, the seven stars in the right hand of Christ. They're the seven angels of the seventh church. And you can't have the Holy Spirit here without having the church here or the seven candlesticks here, can you? No. The whole idea of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit is a picture of the oil inside the literal candlestick. Oil is always a picture of the Holy Spirit. From one end of the Bible to the other, and you won't even get an argument on that from the liberals or conservatives. That's understood. Well, then he says, and another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense. A golden censer was brought from the altar out here to light the incense, and we don't know exactly what was on that. We know that they put incense. Frankincense was nearly put on every sacrifice. It was also brushed on the table of showbread, and it's believed that frankincense was one of the main ingredients that was put on that altar. And then we see that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And there was a silence for about 30 minutes while the priests went in there and took the fire from off the altar and lit that incense, and he brushed the incense out on the fire, and they were waiting to see if the incense was accepted by God, and everyone gathered around, and there was about a 30-minute silence in the heavens or in Israel to see if God was accepting the incense or, in our case, the prayers of the saints. But let me show you something here. It'll show you when you're... Now, I've got a lot more studying to do on some of the other trumpets sounding. When you get to the seven trumpets, of course, we're going to be changed at the last trump. But when you get to the seven trumpets sounding, verse 6, the seven angels which had the seven trumpets, and these are trumpets right here, the arms of the candlesticks are trumpets. This is a type of the oil inside, being the Holy Spirit in us. When we're refined and we're beaten candlesticks, the candlesticks were beaten gold, and we have to be beaten, we have to be refined, and then the oil is put in the candlesticks. There's a reservoir down here. This is not really a good display of it, but this is better than not having one. But there was a reservoir here with oil, and the oil is a picture of the Holy Spirit in us being refined. This is a picture of us, our bodies, and then the light, when the Bible speaks of seven spirits, that's the truth or the light coming from the candlesticks. This is a picture of the church or us being refined. That's why I said this is a picture from 96 A.D. all the way to the end, and the church going through all of these fiery trials to refine us. And seven us is what it's talking about. I don't have any doubt about that. Let me show you what to look for. I showed you some last week on the Euphrates being dried up, how that there was a literal Euphrates dried up by Cyrus, and he was called the anointed of the Lord in the 44th and 45th chapter of Isaiah. He dried up the literal Euphrates to conquer Babylon. The spiritual Euphrates is dried up over here according to the 16th chapter. Look at that one more time, and then I'll come back to this. Don't turn away from chapter 8. Let me just show you this. And here's how I'm thinking when I think. In the 16th chapter, we see the Euphrates dried up, and the sixth angel, verse 12, and if you'll notice, the vials correspond to the trumpets. Most of them are parallel views. When the trumpets sound, only a third of the earth is affected. When the vials are poured out, and the word vial is a word that means a goblet or a cup. Now, we'll get into that later. The sixth, at verse 12, chapter 16, the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. We showed that the river Euphrates means double fruit. When they built Babylon, this huge city on the Euphrates River, they had the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, which was one of the seven ancient wonders of the world. And no wonder it was a wonder, because it was a huge city, and they had this natural irrigation system coming through, and they probably had every kind of tropical plant and anything you wanted to eat in that city. And it was dried up when Cyrus, God's anointed, dried it up and marched into the riverbed and conquered Babylon. And when Christ comes back, he will destroy and dry up the spiritual Babylon, the spiritual Euphrates there in the 18th chapter. And it was all the things, the fruits that thy soul lusted after it departed from thee. And it gives a list of all the things. But if you'll notice here, in verse 13, when you see the Euphrates dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared, I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon. Now remember, dragon. What does that mean? That's a flying dragon that's breathing fire, right?
To fascinate.
Yeah, to fascinate. Drakon. Drakon. That means to fascinate. And has the same basic meaning as the word serpent in Genesis 1:1. The serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field. That's the word N-A-C-H-A-S-H, nakash. That means to enchant or make someone feel good. One of the writers said that means to kill with the eye. Huh? Serpent. Yeah. Huh? S-E-R. Serpent. Yeah, sometimes I forget. Okay. But here's what I want you to notice and be watching for. I saw three unclean spirits like frogs. What does frogs make you think of? One of the plagues of Egypt. Now, a frog is an amphibian. What's peculiar about an amphibian?
It has a mixed nature.
It has a mixed nature, a dual nature, and that's a mixed religion. When people mix them with Jesus, they mix the two together. You have an amphibian. That's what they are. Frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they... Now, here's what's amazing. They are the spirits of devils. Devils is the word daimonion. D-A-I. See, if you'll just define the words... If you define the words, here's what's coming out of their mouth. Distribute fortunes. Sounds like Kenneth Copeland, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Well, that's who it is. Distribute fortunes. It's making you, it is enchanting you and fascinating you and making you feel good. This is not some demon, fire-breathing dragon, St. George and the dragon go and flying around with flapping some goofy-looking fairy tale wings. This is talking about smooth talk. And, gosh, this takes me a dozen places. Let me just show you. When I think, all these things from Aries and Revelation comes to my mind. The 12th chapter, go back to the 12th chapter. This makes me think of this right here. 12th chapter, we see a wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun. This is Israel. She's delivered, travailing in birth. Pain to be delivered. There's a red dragon with seven heads and 10 horns. That's the world beast system. And his tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven. and did cast them to the earth, and the dragon, this is metaphoric language. But when I read that verse in the 16th chapter, that they're the spirits of devils working miracles, they're making you feel good, fascinating you, distributing fortunes to you, working miracles. Fred Price, isn't that it? Or Roberts, make you feel good. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. That's Jesus. That's Israel bringing forth Jesus. Well, you see the dragon persecuting the woman. Now remember, out of their mouth comes frogs, and out of their mouth comes the spirit like frogs, a dual nature, the spirit of Daemon distributing fortunes, fascinating you and making you feel good. Not fire and breathing literal dragons and smoke out of a literal pit and helicopters and nuclear warheads going off. That's not what this is talking about. And then you see the woman, the church, running for her life in the 12th chapter, verse 14. Well, let's look at 13. When the dragon saw that he was cast into the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child. Now, if you'll notice, this chapter is a panoramic view. Pan means to cover all. If you pan the audience, Pan was the god of all. He called himself the all in all. And another title for Pan was Euhodos, or Well-Way. He was the god of the shepherds of the ancient world. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, verse 14, chapter 12, that she might fly into the wilderness into her place where she is nourished for a time, times and half a time, or 3.5 years. 1260 days on a Jewish calendar is 3.5 years on a 360-day year Jewish calendar. It's half of 7 years, the 70th week of Daniel, from the face of the serpent. Now look here. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood. What's coming out of his mouth?
False doctrine.
False doctrine. That's it. Feel-good doctrine. That's the same thing that's coming out of the mouth over there in the 16th chapter. They are the spirits of daemons. The frogs coming out of the mouth are spirits of devils, dual nature people claiming to love Jesus while serving self, another Jesus. So the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the church. What is it that's trying to destroy the church? False doctrine, just like Dan said. That's it, isn't it? No doubt. That he might cause her to be carried away of the flood of false doctrine. That's what comes. That's what started in the garden. When the serpent said, hath God said? He just put in question what God said, and he said it smooth. God really doesn't. He knows you won't die. You'll become like him. You know. And the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood, which the dragon cast out of his mouth, the church. The gates of hell will not prevail against the woman, the church. And the dragon was wroth with the church and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony. By the way, the word testimony is either the word martus, marturia, M-A-R-T-U-R-I-A. It comes from martus, which is the word witness. And we get the word martyr from that. From God's martyrs, and those that are mature, we get the word mature, and what is that we're talking about tonight? What is mature? Being sevened. Right? And where you find it in one place, you find it in another. Now, you never do get through studying all this. These guys who've got a concrete, definite, plain, blunt, nothing answer. Well, the scorpions are helicopters, and the smoke it's a big pit where a big nuclear warhead went off, and it's about a mile in the ground, and smoke's coming out, and these scorpions come out. We don't know whether they're helicopters or bee-like things that comes out of the old movie Them. That's what it reminds me of. They're vivid, silly, stupid imagination. If you define the words, then you can see what it's about. Now let's go back to the 8th chapter. When I'm thinking through the book of Revelation, this is the way I'm thinking. I'm thinking of every other time this is mentioned.
But this 3.5 year stuff, that is the end.
That's the end of it all. Yeah, but see, it starts off. Revelation 12 starts with a woman delivering a man child. And it's actually Israel. It's not Mary. It's Israel. Israel is called the virgin. Even when the scripture says in Isaiah, it says, "The virgin shall conceive and bring forth a son. So thou shalt call his name Emmanuel."
That's saying that there's more false doctrine now at the end time.
Oh, yeah. It's a flood. And flood, by the way, flood. What does that make you think of? Does anybody remember?
No.
Well, yeah, but the flood tried to drown the church then and didn't. Flood, look at Daniel. Look at Daniel 9. Daniel 9, and thinking of a flood, go back to where you find the floods. Daniel 9, when 77s are determined upon Israel in verse 24 to do these six things to upon thy people and thy holy city to finish the transgression, make an end of sins, make reconciliation for iniquity, bring in everlasting righteousness, seal up the vision and prophecy, and anoint the most holy. I'm not going to 7 weeks, I'm just bringing out a point. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth the commandment to restore and build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks, 62 weeks. The street shall be built again in the wall in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the Prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. And the end thereof shall be with a flood. What kind of a flood do you think it is? It's the same kind of flood that's going out to flow over the church when Israel is the Old Testament church, and a flood flooded over them, and that was a literal flood. God called it an overflowing scourge in the 28th chapter of Isaiah. Look at that. Go back over there. 28th chapter of Isaiah. Isaiah 28. And wherever you find it one spot, you're going to find it all over the... You're going to find it everywhere. Isaiah 28, and look here in look at verse 2 when he talks about, well, verse 1, woe to the crown of pride to the drunkards of northern Israel, Ephraim it says, whose glorious beauty is fading flower, which are the head of the fat valleys of them that overcome with wine. He's talking about spiritual drunkenness. Behold, the Lord hath a mighty and strong one, which as a tempest of hail and destroying storm, as a flood of mighty waters overflowing, shall cast down the earth with a hand. The crown of the pride of the drunkards of Ephraim shall be trodden underfoot, and it'll be like a flood of waters. And that'll be the flood of doctrine, and it will be the Babylonians that come in and carry Judah away into captivity. Northern Israel is the Assyrians. But let's go back over here to Revelation. I'm just saying, when you think of a flood, see what it is and what did it do to Israel? It devastated them. And was the Babylonians false doctrine? Well, yes, they were. Their chariots came in first. Then they took Israel into captivity and fed them all these lies. When they came back, they brought a lot of it with them. But go back to the 8th chapter. I want to show you how to think when you're looking at these things. How to think about Revelation, about the sevens. Look here in... So we see the seven angels in verse 6. The seven angels are the refined messengers of God, which had the seven trumpets. The word trumpet is salpinx. And a salpinx is a part of your throat that gives the vocal sound. It's the part of your voice box. They call it the salpinx, same as a trumpet. And the voice, in fact, if you remember in the first chapter, you got trumpets here. Let me just point this out as we go along. go back to the first chapter. You have to prove Scripture with Scripture. Look here in verse 10. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. Then look at chapter 4. Look at chapter 4. And this I looked, and behold, and a door opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me. The trumpet sounding is our voices. We are the candlesticks. It would be like these candlesticks sounding would be like the flames being lit on the top of the candles. That's the light that this is going to give to the world. And the light that we give is the truth from our mouths. And that's the fire from the mouth of the two witnesses, which is the priest and the king. That's us. Everybody's missing this because they get into the literal and they got all these literal trumpets sounding and literal. It's really a mess. You've got seven trumpets sounding here. At the sounding of the seventh trumpet, I'm going to be straight with you. I don't understand all of this, but I can see the figurative language in it all. Let me show you specifically on this second angel sounding its trump. The second angel sounded. Well, let me go back to the first angel. First angel sounded. There followed hail and fire mingled with blood. Now, when you think of blood, hail, and fire, what else do you think of? The plagues of Egypt. That's right. And what are the judgment? And what are we pronouncing? Aren't we pronouncing God's judgments? And what are the judgments of God? The sword, the famine, the pestilence, and the beast, from one end of the Bible to the other. When these trumpets are sounding, which is our voices preaching truth, I don't know if y'all understand this. I know a lot of the world thinks I am crazy. I know they think he is too hard and too mean. If God ever deals with you and makes you look at the world through eyes as jaded as mine, I don't trust anybody in the world. I don't trust doctors and lawyers, and I don't trust preachers, and I don't trust real estate agents, and I don't trust insurance people, and I just don't hardly trust anybody unless they have Christ working in them. I believe a man that doesn't have Christ working on him, he will do the most devious, dirty deeds that a man can imagine. Do I believe doctors will cheat you in order to get rich? Oh, every day. They're going to keep you coming in the office.
I think they'll kill you.
They will kill you, and they won't tell anybody, wouldn't they, right, Billy? They bear their mistakes, that's it. And they won't even tell anybody that, well, I made a mistake. They'll hide it, and there's an unspoken fraternity there, and you're not supposed to tell off on anybody. Isn't that right? And they do kill people, and they overload you with medicine you don't need, and they've given me so much. You know, I'll need to be with me when I talk to my doctors. You wouldn't believe it sometimes. You're not going to heal me, and I don't believe it, and I believe you want me to come back in here. We're going to do this. No, you don't need to do nothing. You haven't healed me yet, and you've been putting me through all kinds of experimentation and doing all these tests on me for 35 or 40 years. And I'm always telling them, you're not going to heal me. You're treating the symptoms. That's all you're doing. And they'll go, just look at me, goofy. It's because they don't know. I can be a doctor. All you got to do is prescribe an antibiotic and a histamine, and a week later, put them on a Medrol pack, and then a week after that, give him a steroid shot, and that's it. That's all you get for anything. Now, isn't that right, Billy? That's about it. Anybody can do that. Just learn a little bit of Latin, and you're home free. And go stick your shingle up somewhere in the north and say, I'm Dr. Brown. I charge $100 a visit. Get rich. Now, the first angel sounded, there followed hail and fire mingled with blood. There's a lot more studying to do on that. And they were cast into the earth, and the third part of the trees were burned up, and all green grass was burned up. Now, I want you to understand something here. Here's where I'm thinking here. First of all, I look at the first trumpet, and then I go over to look at the first vial, and you see real close similarities in what's happening. The difference is the third part is destroyed here, and it's completely destroyed under the vials, drinking the cup of God. It's like what's coming out of our mouths is partial judgment at first, and then total judgment is going to be pronounced at the end.
Could that be when the sky turns to brass and the ground turns
to gold? Yeah, but that's been going on for thousands of years. When the sky is brass, that means no rain. And when the ground is iron, well, and that very well can... Now, I'm wrestling with something. I've been thinking about calling Jack Van Hippie. And I've also been thinking about jumping off the top of the building on my head, if I had been thinking about that. No, I've been wrestling with how that famine is a literal thing, but it has a spiritual connotation to it. In order to have famine, the elements of the earth have to be involved. Now, I believe that we've got the sun being darkened and the moon turning to blood. With something to turn to blood was an old ancient idiom. If you look this up under blood in some of your encyclopedias, particularly McClintock and Strong, it'll tell you that something becoming blood meant to die. Well, if the moon dies, that means it becomes darker and darker. And the darker the night gets, that means that's a picture of no truth. The darker the world gets, the less truth. But I believe that even possibly what we're going to see is the actual sword, famine, pestilence come again upon the earth. And it's already here. You have to keep reminding yourself. When you say, well, it's not here now, I feel pretty good. You live in America, too, and that's less than 5% of the world's population. Famine is running rampant all over the world. And we're sitting on the verge of national and international bankruptcy for the United States. We're sitting on the verge of all of this. And we got famine all over the world. I've got several books on the greenhouse trap, the greenhouse effect, and how that the chlorofluorocarbons, we're using so much of that. They come up with here a few years ago. You could go down here and for $20, they would put Freon into your air conditioner, your car. And now it takes, a man has to be licensed. And the minimum they're going to charge is about $275 or $300 now. It used to be about $20 back about 18 years ago. And that's, they say that's because they're having to put controls, emissions controls on this. But the same thing that's causing the pollution of the lakes and the waters and the streams is the same thing, and the air is the same thing that's polluting our lives called sin. That's because these men that run these companies are dumping into everything. It's cheaper to pay the fine than it is to put these emissions control on their companies. Now, I'm not on an ecological kick. I just believe it's going to happen along with the spiritual, and that it's going to have spiritual connotations, and this very well can mean... Well, of course, we know I've been following the El Nino since about 1970, or maybe even a little before that, first time I heard of it. And until it got real serious in the early 90s, they didn't think it was necessary to say anything about it. But El Nino is larger. It's a larger mass area off the coast of Argentina. It's larger than the United States. The square miles out there is larger than the United States, where the trade winds are ceasing to blow and the ocean is evaporating into these jet streams being carried all over the world and causing all kinds of havoc. And I used to try to keep up with a lot of the blights on the crops around the country and the lack of rain here, the lack of snow there. We used to have a biologist that come here, and he said, you've got to have so much snow in Nebraska to have the right kind of crops, because he would tell me the particular kinds of nutrients in the snow that they had to have to bring out certain crops out there. Well, when the snows and the rains, when everything gets out of kelter, the ecosystems of the world are set up by God. And when we start playing with them for money and selfishness, and that's the Baal that we served itself, then God's going to send, by the very balance of the ecological systems of the world, when we play with it, the famine will come by its very nature.
It's like you ever said,
And it's coming. That's right. And it is on its way. Now, but look here, in the, when the second angel sounds, the second angel sounded as it were a great mountain burning with fire. Well, of course, a mountain was a capital city of an empire. And let me read the rest of this. And with fire was cast into the sea. Here's the key words. Burning mountain. Burning mountain and cast into the sea. Get these key phrases down and you'll find out what this is about. Burning mountain. And then cast into the sea. These are key phrases from one end of the Bible to the other. Let's go back over here to just to show you're going to have to use Old Testament to interpret this. This is allegorical language. It's figurative. Go back to Jeremiah. Jeremiah 51st chapter. When you're interpreting this, and we're still talking about the sevens because these are the seven angels. And when we're pronouncing, in order to be the seven, sounding the seven trumpets, or the refined voice of the church as it speaks the truth, that's the seventh message of God coming from our mouths. I started to say earlier, I know that people think I'm crazy. God has really sevened me. God brought me to death several times. And I arrogantly got up out of bed and went right back to trying to get rich. I don't know why God has chosen me to do this, but I try to be as hard as I can on sin and concerning truth. And the world thinks he's out of his mind. He's too hard. A lot of people leave grace and truth because they think I'm just too mean. God dealt with me to do that, and when he deals with you to do that, you will do it. Necessity is laid upon me. I must do this. It's not a choice anymore. It's something when God deals with you, you know you have to do it. You will be seven. If God will grab you by the throat and just strangle you and say, you'll do it my way, you're going, oh, yes, sir. That's all you can say. I wasn't always mean. I was the quietest little, generous little boy. My mother said I played by myself, and I never caused no trouble for nobody, and I was real quiet, and I never hardly said nothing. I was just a nobody, and God's dealt with me. He has sevened me. I know that. I know what this sevening means. If he ever sevens you completely, people are going to think you're bitter and angry and mean. That's what they're going to think. Don't you think that people thought that about Jeremiah when he's walking through the streets and standing in the streets shouting, repent, judgment's coming, you're all going to die. Don't run for your life. Submit to Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. If you run, you die. This guy had to be nuts to be saying this. John the Baptist was screaming repentance to Israel. And they were so put out by the Roman Empire pressing them and got a man running around telling us to repent. Just one man alone. Look here. Jeremiah. Jeremiah 50. What did we just read? We just read about a great mountain burning, right? Well, let's look over here about the destruction. The first time Babylon was destroyed in the 50th chapter of... chapter 50 and 51 of Jeremiah is about the downfall and destruction of literal Babylon. Literal Babylon... God has painted it out. He's got the literal happening in the Old Testament. He's got the very image in the New. Look here in... He's speaking about Babylon, verse 28, chapter 50. The voice of them that flee and escape out of the land of Babylon to declare in Zion the vengeance of the Lord our God, the vengeance of His temple. called together the archers against Babylon. All ye that bend the bow and camp against it round about. This is a prophecy of the downfall of literal Babylon. Let none thereof escape. Recompense her according to her work, according to all that she hath done, do unto her, for she hath been proud against the Lord. Of course, she began at Babel with, let us make us a name, against the Holy One of Israel. Therefore shall her young men fall in the streets, and all her men of war shall be cut off in that day, saith the Lord. Behold, I am against thee, O thou most proud, saith the Lord God of hosts, for thy day is come, the time that I will visit thee. The most proud shall fall and stumble. When people say, where do you get Babylon's proud? How about right here? And none shall raise him up, and I will kindle a fire in his cities, and it shall devour all around him. Verse 35, a sword is upon the Chaldeans, the magicians of Babylon, saith the Lord, and upon the inhabitants of Babylon, on her princes, upon her wise men. A sword is upon the liars, they shall dote. A sword is upon her mighty men, and they shall be dismayed. A sword is upon their horses, upon their chariots, upon all the mingled people. Those people have commingled their beliefs into Israel. They are in the midst of her, and they shall come as a woman. A sword is upon her treasures. Now, look over here in 51. This is a consummation of Babylon's destruction. Thus saith the Lord, verse 1, behold, I will raise up against Babylon and against them that dwell in the midst of them that rise up against me a destroying wind. And notice verse 2. And will send unto Babylon fanners. This word fanners is the same fans that they use at the winnowing press. And John the Baptist calls baptism. He says, there comes one after me. Well, let's read this, because this all connects together. I'm giving you connecting thoughts. Look at Matthew 3. We've got to read it. Because we see the destruction of Babylon in the 51st chapter. And when you go to Matthew, the 3rd chapter, John talks of baptism as being a type of the winnowing fan or the winnowing fork as it separates the wheat when they would get up on a little hill or crest and they would throw with the winnowing fork, they would throw the fan, they'd throw the wheat into the air, and the wind, when a wind was there, it would blow away the chaff and the buds of wheat would fall down into the press. And John the Baptist equates baptism with that cleansing process of the wheat. Look here. So baptism, that's when Babylon has to be cast into the sea. Look here. Wait a minute. That's not Matthew. That's Revelation 8. Here's Matthew. Yeah, okay. Matthew, third chapter, verse 11, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose winnowing fan is in his hand. He will thoroughly purge his floor of the wheat threshing floor, and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. The point I'm getting at, baptism is blood. It's a death to self. And that's when we're cast into the sea. And that's equated with the baptism of repentance. Go back over to the 51st chapter. I'm getting to the point. I'm trying to show you when you get into this great mountain burning with fire. That's Babylon. A proud mountain. A mountain was a capital city. She had thrown herself against the mountain of God, Zion. where the temple sits, where God's law to us emanates from. Go back over here to the 51st chapter. Now I will send unto Babylon fanners that shall fan her and shall empty her land. For in the day of trouble they shall be against her round about. Against him that bendeth, let the archer bend his bow, and against him that lifteth himself up in his brigandine, and spare ye not her young men, destroy ye utterly all her host. Now he's talking about the destruction of Babylon, and he goes on and describes this all the way through here, but go over here into the 24th verse of this chapter. Remember that second trumpet sounds, and we see a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea. Burning mountain and cast into the sea is what we're working on. Look here in the 24th verse. This is the destruction of Babylon. 51:24. I will render unto Babylon and to all the inhabitants of Chaldea all their evil that they have done in Zion in your sight, saith the Lord. Isn't this amazing? This is the sovereignty of God. Because God said, I'll call Nebuchadnezzar down and cause him to destroy Jerusalem and Israel, and then I'll call him to account for it. How's that for predestination and sovereignty? Behold, I am against thee, O destroying mountain. God calls Babylon a proud mountain. He said she's a destroying mountain, and then he calls her a burnt mountain. And we see a mountain burning, being cast into the sea. It, in Revelation 8, in verse 8, that's the second trumpet sounding. O destroying mountain, saith the Lord, which destroyest all the earth, I will stretch out mine hand upon thee, and roll thee down from the rocks, and will make thee a burnt mountain. Well, remember Revelation 8 and 8. And the second angel sounded, and as it were a great mountain burning with fire. That's figurative language about the destruction of Babylon, isn't it? Huh? You want to go back and read that in Revelation 8, 8? I'm not through with Jeremiah 51. Whatever is happening in the literal in the Old Testament is going to be happening in the new spiritually. Well, you see a burnt mountain burning. You see a great mountain being cast into the sea burning with fire, right? And God says in Jeremiah 51 and 25, I'll make you a burnt mountain. We see a burning mountain here, don't we? Well, go back over to Revelation 18. 18, you see Babylon burning, don't you? Revelation 18. And he says, Babylon is fallen in verse 2. That's because Babylon fell once as a literal kingdom. It's going to fall the second time as an evil spirit kingdom. And it's the system of self and wealth and money and me and all that I want. Then God tells his people, he says in verse 4, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partaker of her plagues, and that, of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. And then you get down here in verse 8, therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire. There's the burnt mountain, isn't it? Huh? That's the burnt mountain, because we're talking about Babylon is fallen from verse 2. In chapter 17 is a description about this harlot and who she is. Verse 18 of chapter 17 says, the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth, Babylon. Not just Catholicism, Babylon. Babylon is a let us make us a name system, a system of self and wealth. She's been a proud mountain. She's a destroying mountain was a mountain that destroyed other cities. A destroying mountain was one that would come up against, they would attack a city, and even if they had a big wall and a deep moat, they would come in and they would set a mountain up, pile of dirt. If they couldn't get into the city, they would set a pile of dirt up. And they called that a destroying mountain or a fortress. And they would run their chariots up there and come down and just destroy them. She was a destroying mountain. God said, I'll make you a burnt mountain. So this is what This is all the destruction of Babylon. When we are pronouncing as the second trumpet, we're pronouncing the judgment of Babylon being cast into the sea, aren't we? Am I losing y'all here? This is terminology. You've got to find it all over the scriptures. This is Babylon being destroyed. And look at verse 9. He said, she'll be utterly burned with fire, for strong is the Lord God who judgeth her. This is Babylon from the first, from the second verse. By the way, let me go ahead and give you something in the second verse. Now, birds were considered as equated with Satan. I've got a book on all the birds of the Bible. It's very interesting. He cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, second verse of chapter 18, Babylon is fallen, and is become the habitation of Daimonion, distributing fortunes. That's what she's become, and that's what God's going to destroy. Devils is the word Daimonion, meaning to distribute fortunes. That's the message of Satan. This is not some evil-looking thing. This is something that looks real nice. Makes everybody happy when they see it. It fascinates them and enchants them. It's good words and fair speeches. It's close to the doctrines that we have learned, but it's not on target. We're to avoid them. And the verse 9, and the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and lived deliciously with her. What does that mean? Buying and selling. Money, 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 money. It's what it's about. Shall bewail her and lament for her, when they shall see the smoke of her burning. I'll make you a burnt mountain. And we see a mountain. We see a mountain cast into the sea, don't we? Go back over here and let's look. You see, there's not. Mary used to come. She reminded me the other day. She said, I used to come. She said, all these people call on the phone. They want a quick fix, a real quick answer. She used to come up to me and say, I want to ask you a question, and I don't want over two sentences for an answer. Three at the most. Just give me a straight answer. And she'd ask me a question. I'd say, I can't answer that. I'd say, I have no three sentences that will fix that. That's it. So there are no quick fixes in Revelation. You've got to go where you find all of the meanings of these words. So we see a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea. Cast in the sea is a type of baptism. And that's what, notice this, cast in the sea is a type of baptism. That's what's got to happen to Babylon, and that must be what happened to her over in the 51st chapter of Jeremiah. And that's equated with baptism of repentance, which is a type of the winnowing fan. It's a purification process. Baptism is a purification process, not H2O, not water, but blood. And that purifies us. In a blood baptism, what else would you call that? What's the subject we're talking about tonight? Sevening. Blood baptism would be to be sevened, wouldn't it? This is what it's talking about. Now let's go back over here and let's see if Babylon gets washed in the sea.
When Jesus told Peter, you need to be cast into the sea.
Yeah. Well, all of these, all those places, we're going to go back and touch those, you know. Yeah, he told him that, didn't he? You need to, he said, you need to say to this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea. There we are, back to the same thing. Same thing. Look back over here in Jeremiah, the 51st chapter. He said, I'll make you a burnt mountain in verse 25. Look at verse 26. They shall not take thee a stone for a corner, nor a stone for foundations. Now, some people, and we'll read this last phrase, but some people say, well, Babylon will rise again on the Euphrates River. And Grant Jeffries, that so-called prophecy teacher, said, and Babylon will rise up again, and Saddam Hussein says he is the new Nebuchadnezzar, and he's going to build a dam on the Euphrates and dam up the river that's never been done before, and he forgot that Cyrus did it. And then he says, and they're going to raise up Babylon again. This Babylon will never raise up again forever. Look at the next phrase. But thou shalt be desolate forever, saith the Lord. The Babylon that rises at the end of time is an international city of wealth and self and money and self-esteem. It's a worldwide city. And the United States propagates it as much as anybody I know. Let us make us a name. You know what this is like? This is like a real complex math problem. That's what it is. You just get all the parts in there, and you never finish getting the answers. Do y'all understand what I mean? You never finish the answers on this puzzle. You study this to eternity. Now, look here in verse 33. Well, look at 32 and 33. I need to read up before that, but I'll just read. And that the passages were stopped, and the reeds they have burned with fire, and the men of war are frightened. And thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, the daughter of Babylon is like a threshing floor. It is time to thresh her yet a little while, and the time of her harvest shall come. So the washing of Babylon is equated, just like John the Baptist equated baptism of repentance with a threshing floor, when they would take the winnowing fan. And at the first part of that chapter, he talks about the fanners will come against Babylon. That's when they'd throw the wheat in the air and the wind would blow away the chaff. It's equated with the same thing, but you've got to have a casting into the sea, don't you? Well, look here. Let's go on down here further. Let's go to verse 42. The sea came upon Babylon. She is covered with the multitude of the waves thereof. There is the casting into the sea, equated with the winnowing fan, the fanners right here. Her cities are desolation. This is the washing of Babylon, but she has nothing redeemed. She has nothing to redeem. When we're redeemed, God will wash us of these bodies, and we're looking for the redemption of the body for brand new bodies, and we're being going through a blood baptism. That's a completion, or that's us being sevened, isn't it? And I will punish Baal in Babylon and will bring forth out of his mouth that which he hath swallowed up, and the nation shall not flow together any more unto him. Yea, the wall of Babylon shall fall. Now, go to the last verses of this chapter. Let's start here in verse 60. Verse 60. And let's watch Babylon collapse. So Jeremiah wrote in the book all the evil that should come upon Babylon, the proud mountain that God's going to make a burnt mountain, even all these words that are written against Babylon. And Jeremiah said to Seraiah, when thou comest to Babylon, and shalt see and shall read all these words that I have written, then shalt thou say, O Lord, thou hast spoken against this place to cut it off, that none shall remain in it, neither man nor beast, but that it shall be desolate forever. How about a second time it will never rise again? This Babylon will never rise again. When the Bible says Babylon is fallen, the first time, that's literal Babylon, is fallen, and that's the second time, that's a spiritual, evil, international city of self and wealth and me and what I want. Money. And it shall be when thou hast made an end of reading this book that thou shalt bind a stone to it. Remember that they acted out their contracts? Huh? And when they acted out a contract, they would perform their contracts in front of 2 to 3 witnesses. And this was verification in their courts what had been done or what's going to be done. And when Ezekiel laid on his side for so many days for all that God was going to do to Israel, then he said over these many days, lay on your other side and knock these tiles down in the eyes of the people. That's a contract. Here's a contract. Thou shalt bind a stone upon it and cast it into the midst of the Euphrates, and thou shalt say, thus shall Babylon sink. Babylon is going to be cast into the sea and shall not rise from the evil that I will bring upon her. She's cast into the sea, isn't she? Huh? And they shall be weary. Thus far are the words of Jeremiah. Cast into the sea was idiomatic. Go back and read Revelation 8 and 8 now. Now let's go back and read that. Revelation 8. Verse 8, and the second angel sounded as it were a great mountain burning with fire. There's no doubt what that is there? Was cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood. I like what Mr. Fairburn says in his book on Revelation. I didn't get a lot out of here, but I like some of the things he says. He's talking about the third part was showing the mercy of God, that he wasn't destroying all things, but when you get to the vials, all is going to die in the sea. A third part here, that when you get to the vials, that's talking about drinking of the cup of God. And he says, I'm going to give my cup. He said, anyone takes a hold of Israel, he said, they will be a cup of trembling in my hand. That's the vials or the bowls. The word vial means a goblet that men are drinking down. And God says, here is what I'm going to make you drunk with. Now let's look at cast into the sea. Let's go back over here to Revelation 18. When you get to Revelation 16, there's like a parenthesis between Revelation 16 and Revelation 19. Revelation 17 and 18, they're just like a parenthesis. 17 is a description of Babylon, who she is. Who she is, it's that great city that reigns over the kings of the earth. And then 18 is a graphic description of her destruction. But you've got her, you've got pictures of her being destroyed all through Revelation. These are not sequential events. They are simultaneous views, some of the same happening. Gosh, I want to show you that, but I need to come back to that. I want to show you this right now. Now look here in Revelation 18. We see Babylon being destroyed, and we see... Hold on, I've flipped away from there. We see Babylon being destroyed, and that's the system of self and wealth. This happens at the very end of time. How much time do I have, Mike?
7 minutes.
Huh?
7.
I need more time than that. Boy, I get it. Now look here. Here's a description. Here's a description of her. Of course, we talked about how that there's a list of all of her wealth. When you see the smoke of her burning in verse 9, standing afar off for fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, that great city Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour thy judgment comes. And then we see the river, we see all the fruit that the river produces. And it names a list of all of the very finest things in the first century. This would be the fruit of the spiritual Babylon. Gold and silver and precious stones, pearl, fine linen, purple, silk, scarlet, thine wood, all manner of vessels of ivory, vessels of precious wood, brass and iron and marble, cinnamon, odors, ointments, frankincense, wine, oil, fine flour, wheat, beef, sheep, horses, chariots, slaves, souls of men, and the fruits, that's what the Euphrates produces. When it is dried up, There'll be no more Babylon. When there is no more Babylon, there is no more let us make us a name. The end is here. The fruits that thy soul lusted after departed from thee. Euphrates means double fruit. And all things which were dainty and goodly are departed from thee. This is about stuff and money. It's what it is. And thou shalt find them no more at all. And the merchants of these things which were made rich by her. That's talking about literal riches. That's not something wildly spiritual and smoky in the distance. It's talking about literal riches. Shall stand afar off for the fear of her torment, weeping and wailing. And saying, alas, alas, that great city was clothed in fine linen and purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls. For in 1 hour so great riches has come to naught, and every shipmaster and all the company and ships and sailors. Ships were their method of getting all these riches to all the world. And as many as trade by sea stood afar off and cried when they saw the smoke of her burning, the burnt mountain, the second trumpet of Revelation 8 and verse 8. Saying, what city is like unto this great city? And they cast dust on their heads. And they cried, weeping and wailing, saying, alas, alas, that great city wherein were made rich all that had ships in the sea by reason of her costliness. For in 1 hour is she made desolate. Rejoice over her, thou heaven, ye holy apostles and prophets, for God hath avenged you on her. You were killed by her. That's who killed the prophets. The Pharisees was a Babylonian system of synagogue worships, and Jesus said, you garnish the sepulchres of the prophets, you hypocrites. How's that for sticking something in there? Now look at the next verse. This is like that last two verses of Jeremiah 51. You can just put that right to the side here. And a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and cast it into the sea, saying, thus with violence shall that great city Babylon be thrown down and shall be found no more at all. Babylon was cast into the sea, wasn't she? Now we really understand Revelation 8 and 8. This is not talking about just some literal happening. It's about the destruction of Babylon. Look at Revelation 8, verse 8, when the second angel sounded, as it were a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea. You've got the destruction of Babylon in the sixth chapter of Revelation. There's a great earthquake. And the stars of heaven fall into the earth. Verse 13. The heaven departed as a scroll when it rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, verse 15 of chapter 6, and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains of the mighty men and every bondman, every free man hid themselves in dens and rocks of mountains. Said unto the mountains, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come. That's the end. They're not in a series. It's sequential. Things happening, different views of the same thing. And then you have the end of, then you have the demise of Great Babylon, Revelation 8 and 8. Then you've got the end of Babylon, Revelation 10. In verse 7, in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God is finished. That's the seventh angel at the last trump. That's when we'll be changed. And then when the seventh angel sounds in Revelation 11 and 15... the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and His Christ, and He'll reign forever and ever. That's the end. That's the destruction of Babylon. Then you have the destruction of Babylon over here in the 14th chapter. And this is the picture of Armageddon, but you don't have Armageddon mentioned until you get to the 16th chapter. But in the 14th chapter, we see the very picture of the four. At the end of the 14th chapter is a picture of the 16th verse of the 16th chapter. I'll read that. And he gathered them together in a place called in the Hebrew tongue, Har Megiddo. Har is the word mountain. It means the valley of the mountain. Or this is the valley of Jehoshaphat there in Zechariah, the 14th chapter. This is talking about when Christ comes back. But here's the treading of the winepress, the end of time. In Revelation 14 and verse 15, another angel came out of the temple crying with a loud voice to him that sat on the cloud, thrust in thy sickle and reap, for the time has come for thee to reap. For the harvest of the field of the earth is ripe. And he that sat on the cloud thrust in his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped. And another angel came out of the temple which is in the heaven, he also having a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the altar which had power over fire, and cried with a loud cry to him that had the sharp sickle, saying, thrust in thy sharp sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for our grapes are fully ripe. This is the captains and the kings of the earth of Armageddon in verse 16 of chapter 16. And this is the same war in chapter 19 where Jesus comes back and he tells all the birds of the air in verse 17 and 18 to come and eat the flesh of kings and the flesh of captains, that he's going to tread in the winepress and all the earth is going to attack Christ. And when you see in verse 19 of chapter 14, the angel thrust in his sickle in the earth and gathered the vine of the earth and cast it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trodden without the city, and blood came out of the winepress even to the horse bridles by the space of 1,600 furlongs. And this is the end of time. This is the destruction of Babylon. This is the same as Armageddon in verse 16 of chapter 16. And it's the same as, huh? What? Well, it's not going to be blood this deep. It's like most of the writers say, it's going to be such a bloody battle. A picture of a bloody battle then was blood splattering everywhere. It'll splash on the bridles of the horses. It doesn't mean it'll be that deep, because there's no such thing. There's not that much blood in the world to cover a valley and all of the bodies of all the people in the world. So it's talking about the blood splattering that high.
184 miles long.
Yeah, 184 miles, yeah. So there's not that much blood in the world. This is all, may I remind you, figurative language. And I believe that, and there is a spiritual Gog and Magog there in the 20th chapter. I don't have time for all this. I think I'm out of time, ain't I?
Yeah.
There's a spiritual Gog and Magog, and we'll hit that too.
Where is it?
20th chapter of Revelation. But spiritual Gog and Magog, and Gog was the land between the lakes, not up here in Kentucky, but between Caspian Sea and the Black Sea. I got to stop here. So when you're thinking, and I haven't gotten to cast into the sea yet. We hadn't even got there yet. I barely hit a couple of verses on it, but we really hadn't covered that at all. So when you get into this, if it's not figurative language, you can forget all that I've said. It don't mean nothing. But it is. Huh? It's, I love this book because it's like, It's like a real complicated game. It's finding the pieces all over the Bible. Hey, look here, it fits here, and this fits here, look here. It's like a jigsaw puzzle. Once you get a big section in the middle, it's not hard to find pieces. It's hard to find the first two pieces, isn't it?
But there's no edge
pieces. Yeah, there ain't no edges. It has no finish. Yeah, you're right, Dad. It's like starting a puzzle, and where does it end? Well, as long as you want to keep working it forever, it keeps going. You're never going to find all the answers to everything in Revelation. You will simply keep studying, keep studying, keep studying. And when you look at the figurative, you're going to find the answers from now on, as long as you live. These quote prophecy preachers that get up, well, this is helicopters, and this is smoke, this is a nuclear warhead here, and that's it, the end. Duh. So, let's pray. Father, thank you for truth and for an understanding of these words. Help us to see how to study this. Open it up and reveal it to us. Lord, help us to understand we are these candlesticks and we are these seven spirit in us that's going to pronounce these judgments on the world, and we're even doing it right now. Help us, God, because this don't do anything but make enemies. It scares the sheep sometimes for seeing what's coming, men's hearts failing them for fear for looking on those things that are coming on the earth, as you told us. Give us strength. Give strength to the sheep to endure such hard words. But they're comforting to us, Lord, knowing that you're going to come again and receive us unto you. Give us strength to continue your work and your word, and we'll praise you and continue to praise you only when you give us strength. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Seven.